lecture we are going to look at the use of pumping lemma. So how do you use it? Till now we are well acquainted with the statements of the pumping lemma. What does the pumping lemma say? And we have seen the example of a regular language in the previous video. The language was which consists of the set of strings which are divisible by 3. And for this language, we have seen how pumping lemma holds. Let us see how we can use pumping lemma with certain languages. So our motivation from where we started pumping lemma was given to us a language. We were interested to know whether it is regular or not. And then we have come up with a statement that if a language is regular, then this language satisfies pumping lemma. Let's take a language L. Assume I want to say something about the regularity of this language, whether it is regular or non-regular. I don't know anything about this language as of now. Next, see, now let's try to see how we can use pumping lemma here. So please note that since I don't know whether L is regular or not regular, so first of all, if I know how to make a finite automata for L, I am done. Because in case I come up with a machine here which recognizes this language L, I am done and I can say that it's a regular language. But assume I am unable to make a finite state automata and I just have the language. Now I have to tell whether it is regular or not regular. How will we proceed? In the example we have done in the previous lecture, we have already made a finite automata. So when we look at the this pumping lemma, it is based on the existence of a number p which is greater than or equals to 1, and this p is the number of states in the automata. Now you can see here I do not know what the automata is, so I do not have the value of p. First of all, whenever you are solving any question of pumping lemma, you cannot give this p a value because we do not know what is p. P can be any number greater than or equals to 1. Second thing we realize here is, let's take now let's assume that this language is regular. If this language L, it is regular, then I'm assume it's regular. Then we know that there is a finite state automata for it, and then we assume that the number of states in that automata is p. Next, what the pumping lemma says is, for all the strings in this language whose size is greater than or equals to p, so for all w such that w belongs to L and more w greater than or equals to p, and let me write down those three conditions hold. You should realize here two things. So with the help of a pumping lemma, you can never prove that a language is regular. And the reason is very obvious and again clear here. First of all, here if you're trying to prove that L is regular, then you need to show that these three conditions hold for all the strings whose length is greater than or equals to p. And that's a rather difficult task, because you have to do it for all the strings whose size is greater than or equals to p, and there are infinite number of such strings here. So I'm not saying it's impossible. For such languages, you can actually go on and show that these three conditions hold for all the strings whose length is greater than or equals to p, but you might find it difficult for some other languages. And even in the case you are able to do that, so even in the case of all these strings whose size is greater than or equals to p, if you end up showing that these three conditions hold, Even then, you cannot claim that your language is regular. And the reason we have discussed earlier, if a language is regular, it satisfies pumping lemma. It doesn't mean that if a language is non-regular, it cannot satisfy pumping lemma. A non-regular language can also satisfy pumping lemma. So it is analogous to me saying, let's say, if a student studies for 72 hours before the exam, then he does well. Or let me make the analogy simple. He gets good marks, right? So this is my implication, similar to here. So if a language is regular, it satisfies pumping lemma. And I'm saying if a student studies, he gets good marks. It does not mean that if a student doesn't study, he can't get good marks. So maybe I don't study for my exam, but I somehow cheat and end up getting good marks. So it means that there can be some students who do not study and they end up getting good marks. Same is the case here. So if a language is non-regular, even it can satisfy pumping lemma. But what we can draw from here is, if a student doesn't get good marks, then definitely I can say that the student has not studied, right? Because we know if the student would have studied, he would have definitely got good marks. If you don't get good marks, then I can claim that you haven't studied. Similarly here, if a language does not satisfy pumping lemma, then I can say that it is not regular. But if a language satisfy pumping lemma, then I cannot say anything about that language. We are going to use that here. So how do I go about and prove the non-regularity of a language using pumping lemma? There are certain quantifiers which are used in pumping lemma, and you should be clear about that in order to go with your proofs correctly. Let me write down the statement of pumping lemma once again. Given to you a language L, then what happens? There is a automata for this language in case it is regular. So I'm assuming, so initially I assume that the language is regular. So you can actually, sometimes you end up mixing the proof of this theorem with the problems we look at. So let's not consider this automata here, although the statements of the lemma comes from that proof. But let's look at lemma quite differently. You can otherwise end up getting confused between the two. So for the language L, there exists a number P which is greater than or equals to 1. So again, this P is nothing but the number of states in the automata, but you needn't worry anything about that automata. While solving the problems, you only need to worry about the number P. There exists a number P greater than equals to 1 such that for all the strings W in L whose length is greater than or equals to P, there exists a decomposition. I'm going to say a valid decomposition XYZ, and when I say a valid decomposition, it means the first two statements, that is mode XY is less than or equals to P and mode Y is greater than 0. There exists a valid decomposition XYZ again such that for all I equals to 0, 1, 2, so on and so forth. So for all these values of I, X, Y, I, Z belongs to L. So there are many quantifiers here you should be careful about. So one is here, there exist, one is here for all, then we have a there exist, then we have a for all. And when we prove that a language is not regular, these quantifiers play their role. Let's see how do we proceed with it. So assume that I'm working with a language L and I want to prove that this language is not regular. I'll try proving it. I can never prove that a language is regular using bumping lemma. I am again stressing this fact. Okay, what I'll do, first of all, I am assuming that this language is regular. So assume, so this is to prove. I am going to prove it by contradiction. So I am assuming that L is regular. If L is regular, then there is a machine here. And I assume that the machine has P states. I do not know the value of P. So I cannot give P some value. I don't know the value of P. Next it says, for all the strings whose length is greater than or equals to P, these conditions should hold. If the language is regular, then for all these strings whose length is greater than or equals to P, the following conditions must hold. So to disprove it, to show that the language is not regular, what I just need to show? I just need to show that there is one string here for which these conditions do not hold, right? Because if I can, pumping lemma is saying that for all these strings, the conditions should hold. So assume that these are the strings here. This is the set of strings whose length is greater than or equals to P. For the language to be regular, all of these strings should satisfy the condition. What we'll do is we will smartly pick one of the strings from here and we'll show that these conditions are failing in the case of that string. If we are able to do this, we prove that the language is not regular. Let's simultaneously work with an example so that the things remain clear. Let's take this language L, which is ANBN such that N is greater than or equals to 0. We are trying to prove that this language is not regular. We assume that, so we assume L to be regular. If L is regular, then there exists a machine. If there exists a machine, this shows that there exists a P. P is greater than or equals to 0. Next, I have to take all the strings in this language whose size is greater than or equals to P. So there are going to be an infinite number of such strings whose length is greater than or equals to P. For disproving pumping lemma, for disproving that this language is regular, I just need to pick one string from here and disprove the conditions for that one string. So we fetch one string from here. Please see that when I fetch a string from this subset, that string cannot be this. Why this string cannot be this? Because the string which is being fetched should have P greater than or equals to 0. This string, the string which I am going to fetch should have this thing. Its length should be greater than or equals to P. If I fetch A cube B cube, its length is 6. I do not know whether this 6 is greater than or equals to P. So whenever I am going to pick a string from here, its length should be a function of P. So this is very important. Mod omega should be a function of P. Rather, you can see your omega should be a function of P. Now if we look at the length of this string here, it is 2P, which is greater than or equals to P. And only for this string we are going to prove that those conditions do not hold, and we are done. we are exclusively going to work with this string. Okay, let's go back. Now we have picked a string and we need to show that these conditions should not hold. Let's look at the first condition. So the first condition says that there exists one valid decomposition such that this condition holds again. So what are these valid decompositions first of all? So valid decompositions are which satisfies these two criteria. So again there can be a large number of valid decompositions which satisfy this criteria. So let's see some valid decompositions here. So valid decompositions say x mod x y is less than or equals to p and mod y is greater than 1. So some of the valid decompositions are x is empty, y is a single a and z is ap minus 1 bp. Please notice that this is a valid decomposition. So if you look at mod xy here is 1, right, which is less than or equals to p. And if you look at mod y here, so mod y here is also 1, right? Okay. Another valid decomposition can be this is x, this is y, this is z. So this is also a valid decomposition. So if you look at the length of xy, it's here equals to p, and if you look at the length of y, so y is not empty, it has a length which is, I'm very sorry, this is 0 here. If you look back here, yeah, it's 0 here. There can be several other decompositions. Other decomposition can be so this is my x, this is my y, and this is my z. So this is other valid decomposition. So these are all the valid decompositions. So your pumping lemma says that out of all these valid decompositions, there is at least one for which this condition is satisfied. So for your language to be regular, I need just one valid decomposition to satisfy this. Hence, if you want to disprove it, I cannot just pick one decomposition from here and prove that below condition, the third condition, to be false. That's not the case. Since for proving pumping lemma, you say that there should exist one valid decomposition. So if you want to disprove it, you have to show that for all these valid decompositions, this condition does not hold. Again, analogous to, if I want to say that a class is brilliant, you put up a term in front of me and you say that in order to me to say that a class is brilliant, there should exist at least one student in the class who is brilliant, who is extraordinary. If you want to disprove that the class is not brilliant, you cannot just pick any one student, show that he is not brilliant, and you are done. You need to take every student of the class and you need to show that none of them is brilliant in order for you to prove that class is not brilliant. So similarly here, for all the decompositions, we need to prove that this statement over here is false. And again, to prove that this statement here is false, right? So what does this say? That x, y, I, z should belong to L for all values of I. So in order to disprove it, I can just pick one value of I and show that x, y, I, z does not belong to L. I need not work with all the values of I. So while disproving the pumping lemma, we just need one string. For this one string, we need to show that for all the valid decompositions, there is one I for which x, y, I, z doesn't belong to L. Let's finish off with this example. So how do I do it for all the valid decompositions now? In order for me to do it for all the valid decompositions, I am going to write an expression which depicts all my decompositions. So let's see what all the decompositions can be. Here we have just listed three decompositions. Let's see how we can write down all possible decompositions. So the string we have picked is this. Xp times and then yp times. Conditions given to us are while decomposing. So our string was a power p, b power p, and we have to look at all the possible decompositions which satisfies these two criteria, right? Okay, let's see how we can do that. So if I look at this string, this basically means a written p times and then b written p times. What I'm going to do here is, when I do this decomposition, so let me look at this condition first. So I'm going to do the decompositions such that mod xy equals to m, where m is less than or equals to p, right? What I mean by when I say this is, I have a here p times and then from here b start. So these all initial p entries are a. So what all can xy be? So I'm looking at this substring xy here. Mod xy is less than or equals to p. So you should see that you can never consist of a b in xy. Xy should consist of all a's. Further, mod y is greater than or equals to 1. So what all are the values that xy can take? Xy can be a single a. Please see that xy can never be equal to epsilon. Why so? Because y cannot be equal to epsilon. So xy should have at least one symbol. So xy can be a, or xy can be aa, or xy can be a cube, xy can be a4, so on and so forth. Xy can go up to ap, after that nothing, right? Okay, so to denote all these decompositions, what we have written is mod xy equals to m, where m is less than or equals to p. This covers all of them. Now further decomposition between x and y. So combined we have got xy. Now let's look at what y can be and what x can be. So when mod xy is m, what is my string? So xy is nothing but aaa up to a written m times, where m is less than or equals to p. This is xy. Now I have to distinguish between x and y. So how can we pick the values of x and y? One thing we can do is टेक नथिंग इन एक्स एंड गिव दिस ऑल टू वाई. तो एक्स इज एप्सिलॉन एंड वाई इज नथिंग बट ए हाउ मेनी टाइम्स एम टाइम्स. और गिव वन ए टू एक्स एंड लेट रिमेनिंग एज बी विद वाई. और गिव टू एज टू एक्स एंड गिव रिमेनिंग एज टू वाई. टिल वेयर यू गो? कैन यू गो हियर? गिव ऑल द एज टू एक्स एम एज टू एक्स एंड मेक वाई एप्सिलॉन. नो, दिस कैन नॉट बी. This won't be the decomposition because y should have at least one symbol. So this way we are going to go till where x becomes, x gets a m minus 1 times and y gets an a. So these are all the possible decompositions. You can actually denote it by, so one decomposition I can denote it by, I am going to take q as in y. And I'm going to take remaining m minus q a's in x such that what can be the values of q? Q is in the closed range 1 to m. So you see, if you put the value of q to be 1, you get this string over here, right? Where y is having a 1 time and x is having m minus 1 time. You put q equals to 2, so on and so forth, you go in this direction. When I finally put q equals to m, you get this string over here. So how can we write this decomposition? We can write it as, so x, y can be written as now. A m minus q times a q times such that q is from 1 to m. If you look at this particular expression here, it represents all possible decompositions. So you keep putting different values of m and different values of q and you can derive any possible decomposition from here. And what remains in Z? So since we have taken M A's in X, Y, what remains in Z? How many A's remain in Z? P minus M. And definitely this B P times is there in Z. So here when mod X, Y is M, X, Y is actually nothing but A M. Right. Okay, so we have got the value of xy here, we have got the value of z here, and it represents all possible decompositions. Now for all possible decompositions together, I am working at this expression xyiz, and this expression is going to be x is this, y I times becomes this, and I have z which is this. If you solve it, it becomes p minus q plus iq and b p times. Now to disprove it, as we discussed, we just need to find one value of I for which x, y, I, z doesn't belong to L. So what if I put I to be equal to 0 here? You see, if I put I to be equal to 0, this thing becomes A P minus Q and B P times. Are these two? Does this belong to the language? It will belong to the language when Q is 0. Only then this will belong to the language. But here we already know that Q can fetch the values from 1 to M. So this here does not belong to L. And hence we are done. I request you to go with this proof one more time. So we have done it in a very, we have completely dissected this proof and done it. We have done it this way so that the future proofs are also easy for us. So we are going to use a similar strategy in every proof. In the next video, we will be looking at how do you prove it for a palindrome.